That's my name. It's a name known throughout all of Jerusalem. It's a man known for his crimes. A man known for violence. See, I've been arrested with a group of rebels during the rebellion. And I committed murder. The punishment for my crimes, crucifixion. I was to be nailed upon a cross, and that's where I would die. I would suffer. I would die of suffocation and exhaustion. What a horrific way to think about your own death. But that's what had been sentenced to me. I remember the Romans. They ordered me to make my own cross. The agony. The torture of making the instrument that would be my death. I was going to die there. And the stress of knowing the unbearable pain that I would go through, it was unimaginable. I recall the process of making that cross. Picked up each plank of wood and splinters penetrated my hands, and I knew that was just a part of the pain that I was going to feel on that cross. I imagined my back being thrown against that bare plank and the agony that I would feel as they lifted me up, and those nails, the horrific nails that would be driven through my hands and through my feet. It was petrifying. It was agonizing as I just sat there day after day thinking of the agony, the pain that I would go through on that cross. I knew that I would suffer. I knew that I would suffer long. And it would be agonizing. I sat alone in this cell, this horrific, disgusting cell, not knowing when my time would come. The reality was, I wasn't sorry for what I had done, but I was sorry that I had gotten caught. If I could have done things differently, if things in my life would have just gone a different direction, I wouldn't have been in the predicament that I was in that day, and I surely would not have gotten caught. I would have done things differently. I sat in that cell waiting for the day to come, not knowing, making the cross, enduring the agony of weight, and the smell in that cell was horrific. The uncomfortableness of that wet, rough floor was agonizing. But it was far better than what I knew was waiting for me on that cross. The hairs on the back of my neck stood up. I hadn't realized that a crowd had been gathering outside of my cell. It had been gathering for a long time, and I hadn't even recognized it. But suddenly the hairs, I almost lost myself as I realized the next sound that I heard were the steps of the Roman soldiers as they came to get me from that cell. I got petrified. I got the agony of weight was interrupted by the reality that it was my time to die. I didn't even protest. I just gave myself to them. They bound my hands with chains. They bound my feet with chains. And they marched me to my unimaginable death. I didn't even protest. I didn't interrupt them as they led me through, but what stood out to me was the crowd. That crowd was angry. They were angry and they chanted my name, Barabbas, give us Barabbas, crucify him. And the agony of everything I was going through came to that moment. And then the Roman soldier looked at me. He unshackled my chains and he said, you can go. Perplexed, I looked at him, confused. And then he pushed me and he said, Barabbas, go. You've been set free. I didn't interrupt him. I just made my way. I rushed out to the front and pushed people aside. And that's when I came face to face with him. He was a bloody mess. His back had been torn to shreds. Blood was pouring from every part of his body. But I vividly remember the blood that streamed down his face from the crown that had been put upon his head. And then I made out who that man was. I knew this man. This was Jesus of Nazareth. I had heard stories of this man, how the lepers had been cleansed. Blinded eyes had been opened. There was even a rumor of a man that had been dead 3-4 days. And Jesus brought him back to life. Why was this crowd so angry at him? They called for his name. Crucify him! Crucify him! And the next thing I saw was the Roman soldier grab Jesus and threw him on the cross that I had been working on just hours before. They lifted him up, drove nails into his hands, drove nails into his feet. And Jesus had been silent up until this point, yet he was trying to say something. And I pushed my way to the front of the crowd to make out what Jesus was saying. And I heard him say, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Tears filled my eyes as I realized that's my death. I should be on that cross. I committed murder, not this man. He was an innocent man, yet they requested his life. I'll never be the same after that day. For that was the day that they set Barabbas free so that Jesus could die.
Barabbas. Who is Barabbas? Who was Barabbas? Fact is, we really have no idea who this man actually was. We don't know his lineage other than that he was a Jew. We don't know who his parents were. Were they prominent? Were they part of the social scene of Jerusalem? Were they faithful Jews? We don't know how Barabbas was raised. We don't know what steps he took in life that led him to an imprisonment. We don't know what caused him to join himself together with a bunch of rabble-rousers that all wound up imprisoned for insurrection and murder. We really don't know much about him at all. Mark chapter 27, the gospel writer Mark, gives us just a tidbit. He says that at the feast, the governor was accustomed to releasing to the multitude one prisoner whom they wished. That means that someone requested Barabbas. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, "Who do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?" For he knew that they had handed him over because of envy. They were envious of Jesus. While Pilate sat on the judgment seat, his wife sent to him saying, "Have nothing to do with that just man, for I've suffered many things today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" They said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "What shall I do with Jesus, who is called Christ?" They all said to him, "Let him be crucified." And the governor said, "Why? What evil has he done?" They cried out all the more. At this point, they're just in an emotional frenzy. "Let him be crucified." You know, John was called the baptizer, John the Baptist. One of Jesus' disciples, Thomas, was called the doubter. Another of Jesus' disciples, also named John, was called the beloved. Peter could have been called Peter the loud. Mary, the Magdalene, because she was Mary of Magdala community. Jesus had a friend in the city of Bethany named Simon. They called him Simon the leper. Barabbas could have been called Barabbas the unknown, because really nobody knew him. Nobody knew anything about him. And yet I find it very unlikely that it could possibly coincidence that the translation of his name from Greek to English actually means son of shame. Unknown to us. We don't have details. But I want to tell you today, he was not unknown to God. To God, he had been known since the spark of life was struck within the womb of his mother. Unknown to you and me, but very, very well known to God. Every moment of his life. As a toddler learning to walk, as a child playing outside in the dusty streets of Jerusalem, as a teen learning to find mischief, as a young adult learning to get himself into the middle of stuff that he should never have been, and now as a grown man imprisoned, God knew him start to finish. Barabbas was not an unfamiliar name. All we know is what we can get from the Gospels, and all four Gospel writers give us a little bit. Mark tells us he was chained with his fellow rebels because he had committed murder in the rebellion. They had somehow been involved in some sort of insurrection, a rebellion likely against the Romans there in Jerusalem. And the Romans didn't tolerate such. Gathered up everyone that might have been a suspect, threw him in the prison. That's all we know about Barabbas, imprisoned for rebellion and murder. And it is shocking to me that the crowd of upstanding citizens in the streets would shout for the release of Barabbas. They knew he was a murderer. They knew he was dangerous and violent. But release him so long as Jesus takes his place in crucifixion. Imprisoned because of rebellion. Imprisoned because of murder. Imprisoned because of stirring up trouble within the community. And you see, the Romans, their reaction to such stuff like this was intentional in what they did. They immediately struck fear into the hearts and the minds of the Jews. And frankly, anybody in any domain of the Romans, if you messed with the Romans, if you made them angry, somebody would likely die. They did not tolerate any uprising. That may have had an impact, a bearing on the reaction of the Jewish leaders just a few days prior to this point now in the scriptures where they come to Jesus. Jesus is riding into town. Last week was Palm Sunday. It was that day. Jesus comes riding into town on a donkey and suddenly an impromptu parade happens and they come and find Jesus and say, "Calm your worshipers down. They're going to get the attention of the Romans and somebody's going to die. Jesus, get these people under control." Jesus' response was, "If they don't worship me, the rocks will cry out." The religious leaders were afraid of what the Romans would do. But Jesus showed no fear. What is unfortunate about this event is that those Jewish leaders did not recognize that the one on the donkey was greater than the local Roman garrison. And that the one on the donkey was greater than even Caesar himself. But isn't it funny how it works? With human nature and the human condition, that living under oppression and living under stress and living under depression, eventually the human mind and the human body just begin to adopt it as the norm. It's just the way it is. I'm always going to be depressed. I'm always going to struggle with my mental situation. I'm always going to be under the oppression. I'm always going to fight this addiction. I'm always going to fight this problem. It's just the way my life is. But I want to tell you today that there is one who is even greater than your situation. And you don't have to live under those kinds of conditions. There is one that is greater than what presses you down. He is greater than what steals your hope. He is greater than sickness that can invade the body. He's greater than what diminishes your joy. His name is Jesus, and today we celebrate that He is risen. We celebrate the fact that He gave Himself as my substitute, and He took my place in yours. And when we deserve the punishment that He got for our sins and our failures, He stepped. Killed on a cross. Killed on a cross. 3 days in a borrowed tomb. But during that time, He took a wrecking ball to hell. During that time, He conquered the undisputed champion of time and existence called death. And He took away hell's ability to imprison the souls of mankind. And on the third day, this Easter day that we celebrate today, He walked through a solid rock wall of a tomb, a crypt that had been hewn out of the side of a hill because there was no crypt and no tomb that could contain the life that was in Jesus Christ. It was eternal life. And that same life is available to you and me today. And for that reason that He walked out, the scripture says that those that are dead in Christ will one day rise again and meet Him in the skies as He calls a church home, because those who die physically but were alive spiritually will never die. They will live in eternity, and that eternal life cannot be contained to a tomb a grave, a mausoleum, or wherever the dead may lie. That's what Easter represents. A complete and a total victory for those who have allowed God to rescue them at Calvary. He is risen. To that lady, Mary of Magdala, who showed up on Easter to treat Jesus with respect and go through the embalming process that was cultural to that day. They showed up. Instead of Jesus, they find an angel who says, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. The stone is rolled away. You go look and see if you can find him." And then they went to tell the disciples, and here they come running. It cannot possibly be. Yes, it is. Actually, it cannot possibly not be. He is risen. Anybody glad that he's risen today? Why don't you just take a second and thank him today? Somebody thank him that he took your place. Somebody thank him that your sins have been washed away. Somebody thank him that your failures don't have to dictate and dominate your future. Somebody thank him today that whatever's going on, he is greater. He's greater. From the beginning of mankind, the moment that he breathed the breath of life into Adam, God gave man free will. The ability to choose what you will do when you will do it. The ability to navigate your life well or terribly. The ability to make good decisions or bad. And with that free will, man chose sin. And activated the sinful tendencies of human nature that we struggle with even to this day. It wasn't long after that Cain murdered Abel. And Barabbas is representative of that free will to choose sin and murder. God gave him that right. He literally represents the highest degree of human depravity that you can imagine. Choosing sin, murder, and violence. When he could have chosen goodness and mercy. And in his unrepentant state, lying in that rank and filthy prison, he is the lowest of the low of society. He's at the bottom of the barrel, covered by a layer of scum. He's just at the lowest of the low. So there's something about this whole picture that just makes no sense. Jesus, God, manifest in the flesh, King of kings, King of all glory, no one to compare. As Isaiah called him, wonderful, counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Who else could bear such titles? Who else could handle such responsibility? Nobody but Jesus. The Almighty God. With the capability to snap his fingers and more planets populate our solar system, or even an entirely new solar system created, or even a new galaxy. That kind of power in a man. And it makes no sense whatsoever to trade him for Barabbas. Even if you didn't recognize the fact that Isaiah was describing him as wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. He had just raised the dead in the past few weeks. He had healed more sicknesses than anybody understood. He had walked on water. He had done things that should have given him as much credential as he possibly could have needed. And yet here is a crowd of people who know what they're doing, clamoring to trade him for Barabbas. Judas has already traded him for 30 pieces of silver, the price of a slave. Now he's about to be traded again. Not for silver. He's going to be traded for a life. Not just any life. Barabbas' life. But Barabbas' life was already over. Barabbas was a dead man. Stuck in a cell. He may have been breathing oxygen in and carbon dioxide out, but he knew his days were numbered. He knew that it was just a matter of time. He knew that this isn't going to last forever. They're going to come and get me one day, and it's going to be all over. Barabbas was a dead man. Until Jesus showed. There was no hope that Barabbas would be redeemed. There was no hope that Barabbas would ever do anything good again. There was no hope that Barabbas' life would have any meaningful impact on society or humanity ever again. From the point that the Romans arrested him, his life was over. It's just a matter of time. And yet the Bible in history shows us that this man whose life was now totally bereft of any redeeming value was about to be traded for the life of one who was the Redeemer. A life for a life. But Barabbas' life was over. But it's amazing what happens when the trade takes place. Because Barabbas' life was over until Jesus came onto the scene. And when Barabbas' life was traded for Jesus' life, suddenly Barabbas had life again. And he walks out of the prison cell and he goes back into society. And I can't tell you what Barabbas did. I can't tell you what he did with his next chance. But I can tell you this, that when Jesus made the trade, Barabbas had a whole new opportunity at life again. They weren't going to arrest him for what he had done. They weren't going to come back and get him for the murder. It was all taken care of by the blood of Jesus Christ when he showed up, and he represents you and me, and it still works the same way. Doesn't matter where you came from. Doesn't matter what you've done. There is a trade that needs to happen. My life for his. And then Paul says, I die daily. And then Paul understands that, listen, as I die, I live again. And when I give my life to him, and when I say you can direct it, I will die for you. Then the Lord steps in and gives life abundantly. And everlasting, and joy unspeakable, and power to overcome, and power to get beyond obstacles that seem like they cannot possibly be moved beyond. But because of the trade. Doesn't matter who you are, or what you've done, or where you came from, or who your parents were. Doesn't matter if you were abused. I don't want to make light of something terrible, but I want you to know that what someone else has done to you does not have to hold you hostage. There is a God that loves you. There is a God who put himself in your place and bore the stripes on his back and took that crown of thorns and allowed the nails to be driven through him so that you could walk into the sanctuary on Easter Sunday 2024 and hear Jeffrey Jaco tell you God can still overcome what is stealing the life right out of your heart.
heart, God can still give you hope. He can still give you joy. He can still give you what you need. So I don't want to make light of what you've been through, but I'm tired. I'm tired of seeing depression hold people hostage. I'm tired of seeing anxiety control people's lives. I'm tired of seeing fear get a hold and get a grip on people, and somebody just decide, this is just the way it is for me. This is just my life. No, it is not your life. It is not what God designed for you. He went to Calvary so that you could hear someone tell you, today he is able still to overcome. To the average spectator, nothing about the trade between Barabbas and Jesus makes any sense. But to the strategist, to the greatest strategist, the one who spoke the worlds into existence, the one who knows the end from the beginning, it was full of strategy. It was the most strategic trade ever made. It had far more consequence than buying a stock when it's pennies and watching it grow into the thousands of dollars per share. It had far more consequence than someone who manages to game the market and gain people and steal so much from them and take retirements. It had far more consequence than anything like that. The trade that was about to be made, the most strategic thing you might ever see. God knew exactly what he was doing. See, God always knows what he's doing. He makes no error. He depends upon no chance. He doesn't need the ideal circumstance, he creates it. Barabbas' life is a sermon. It's a message from God. It's a message shouted across the expanses of time and eternity. It's not too late. And you're not too bad. Barabbas is God's message. There is not a life I won't trade for mine. Barabbas is God's sermon. There's no one too bad that isn't worth my blood. Barabbas' life is a message. No matter who you are, what you've done, where you came from, your life, your future, your eternity to God was worth the blood of Jesus and still is. And the greater message is that from the lowest of the low to the highest of the high, everyone is worth the sacrifice that Jesus made. There's not one person that is above or below it. Let me close with this. The reason Barabbas had to be set free was so Jesus could be crucified. And the reason that Jesus had to be crucified was so that Barabbas could be forgiven. And Barabbas is me. Barabbas was all of humanity locked in a prison cell, locked up without hope. Nothing could redeem him. The Romans would not have turned him over to anyone for anything. You couldn't have offered them enough money. They had all the money. You couldn't have offered them any services. They didn't need anything that the Jews had. Nobody could have rescued Barabbas. His life was beyond redemption until Jesus came. And somehow Jesus was enough. So set Barabbas free
so Jesus can be crucified. And crucify Jesus so that Barabbas can be forgiven. So that Barabbas can have hope. So that I could be forgiven. And that you could be forgiven. Now, because Barabbas was me and Barabbas was you. He was all of us. He is the aggregate of humanity. And God was willing to say, I will go to the very lowest of the low. I will go to the very bottom. And I will start there. And I will rescue that man so that you can understand that from the very bottom to the very top of society, I will rescue anyone that comes. There is no one that is below. There is no one that is above. There is no one outside of my reach. Barabbas was me. You know, it's amazing how many times and how many people I'm just going to stop for a second. God, we just need you to wrap this up now. Let your spirit begin to stir and move, work in hearts. Would you stand with me across this room today? Somebody just begin to pray with me. Lord, right now. I was Barabbas. I know it. It should have been me. There's no possible way I could have paid the debt. I'm so thankful that on Easter Sunday, that I know that you're risen. I'm so thankful that on this day that I know that you still love me. God, if I could recount all the mistakes I've made, I'd go into such a depression I don't think I could ever come out. If I could remember all of the bad decisions and choices, if I could just somehow, please don't ever let me. I don't know if I could recover from it. It's amazing to me how many people can hear about how Barabbas was so low and so bad and quickly compare themselves to him and say, but I'm so far better. I'm so far above. I'm so much better than Barabbas. It's amazing how a decent job and a steady income and a home and some cars will cloud the mind and feed the pride of humanity to say, I don't need God. I'm not sick, preacher. I'm not broke. I'm not desperate, nor am I destitute. I don't need God today. It seems like the more that we get, the less and less and less that we feel like we might need Him. So that when I preach a message like this, the comparisons, I can almost see the wheels turning and heads all across this room. But I'm not that bad. I'm not near in the situation. I'm not near in that condition. I'm doing way. Maybe that was me a few years ago, but you know what? Preacher, I've gotten better. Pastor, I've got a good job. I got a house. I got a couple cars. We're doing okay. I'm not sure that we need God like what you're talking about. I haven't murdered anyone. I've caused no insurrection. I've stolen nothing. And yet in your own heart, it's you praying, oh, please don't remind me of my mistakes. Please don't remind me of the times that I got confused and did the wrong thing. Or even did the wrong thing when I intended to, knowing what was going on. You know your struggles. You know your hurts. Those hurts that manifest themselves as depression. anxiety, even the pursuit of things that are destructive, yet you can't seem to shut it down. Overwhelms you, chases you, pursues you. You know your thoughts. You know them better than anybody. The ones that no one else knows about, you know. God knows too. The ones that you wish you could chase out of your head. You know your actions. You know the things you've done that no one else knows about, that you got away with. And because you have a few things, you decide, I don't need God. But I would tell you, when it's so heavy, trying to deal with your successes and that job that you tell yourself is helping you with to not need God, when that job brings stresses that are beyond your ability to handle and you feel like you're about to break in half and crack in two, and you've got so much going on, and yet you've convinced yourself, I got enough, I'm doing okay, I don't need God. I want to tell you, you don't have to live that. I want to tell you that it's okay to have a job and a couple cars and some nice things, but you don't have to live under the spirit of oppression, and you don't have to carry the guilt of yesterday. It's okay to have some success in your life, but it's not okay to reach the point where you decide, I'm good enough without God. You ain't that good. You're never going to be that good. And you're living below your privilege. God has so much more for you. He has so much more for you. Can I just pray for you across this room? Sanctuary, pray with me. Somebody lift up your hands to the Lord and just begin to pray. God, there's people here who desperately needed to hear exactly what I would say today. They're not used to Easter coming across quite like this. But I'm praying right now that your spirit, the very spirit of the Almighty God, would begin to permeate hearts and lives, and would begin to break down walls and dig through calloused hearts until you find a tender place to minister to, and let someone feel the love of God that has seemed distant. Let someone feel the love of God that has seemed like I can never feel that again. I can never experience that again. And yet, here you are. It's amazing how much life happens when there's a trade made, when you trade yourself for me. It's amazing. Oh friend, I want to tell you today, you can leave here walking on cloud nine. You can leave here full of life and joy. You can leave here full of the power of the Holy Spirit. Listen, it's Easter. I'm not going to do some big altar call. I'm not going to put everybody on the spot. But I'm going to tell you right now, if the Lord is dealing with you, if you would just begin to call on Him, God wants to touch your life today. Before you leave, God wants to minister powerfully into your spirit. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God, I pray right now that you would just let your mighty hand do an incredible work in lives. I'll challenge you like this. If you're brave enough... See, we lift our hands as a sign of surrender. It's just like a bank robber who points a gun and says, put your hands in the air. He knows that you can do nothing. Hell knows that you can do nothing. And God knows that you can do nothing. But when you lift up your hands like this and begin to call upon the name of the Lord, it is a message that permeates. It reaches across all eternity. And it finds the Almighty God who exists outside of time and says, here I am, I need you. It's just a blessing. Anybody need Him today? Across this room. Every person that will, every person that can, every person that is brave enough, why don't you do that? Lift up your hands and begin to ask the Lord to minister to you. God, here I am, touch me. Here I am, let your hand minister. Oh, I'm telling you, there's a God that wants to run to you. He wants to bless you and help you. Hallelujah, Lord, I worship you. My soul is blessed. I will bless your name. I will bless you. It's just a blessing. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hang on a second. I'm not one of these preachers that'll drive you crazy and beg you to come and all this mess. I will let you walk out the door without what you need because there's nothing I can do about it. But I will tell you that if you want something from the Almighty God who has risen, who has felt the hurt in your life, who has experienced the pain that you have, who also cried out, "Dear God, let this pass from me. I don't know what to do with it." That was Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane when he cries out, "We don't speak this language, so sometimes we don't understand it. Let this cup pass from me." What Jesus was really saying was, "I don't want to go through with this. I don't want to face it one more day." Is that you? I want you to know there's a trade that is waiting to happen today. The Lord's already taken your place. He's just waiting on you to say, "Okay, God, I'm going to receive what you have for me. I'm going to take what you got." Oh, His Spirit is here, filling this place up. So one more time, I'm going to give you an opportunity, then it's over. Easter service will be concluded in the sanctuary. In Jesus' name, lift up your hands and begin to call on the name of the Lord. And let Him bless you today in this place. In Jesus' name, God, I surrender to you. I'll repent of my sins. I want you to forgive me. I can't live like this. I can't. No longer, no more. It's got something's got to change.
Praise the Lord.
Something's got to give.
Hallelujah.
I can't take the stress. I can't take. Where's the joy? Where's the joy of living? Where's a good reason to get up tomorrow? Is it all gone? Is there nothing left? Oh, there's plenty left. It's in the presence of God. Come on, friend. He is reaching for you. I know you've been hurt. I know you've been damaged. I know you feel like you're at the bottom. But hell wants you to feel like you're there. It's not as bad. And I promise you, in the presence of God, it all gets better.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm free.
Hallelujah. Somebody ought to be singing that today.
I am free.
I'm free. And you started giving me joy, and I started giving you my burdens, and you started giving me hope, and I started giving you my yesterdays, and you started giving me peace, and I started giving you my hurts, and you started giving me healing. There's nothing like the trade. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done for me.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done.
Lord, my soul is resting.
Oh,
it is a blessing.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
I won't keep you. You just dismiss today, please make sure you greet our guests. I just hope the Lord has spoken just a little bit of hope into your heart today. Praise the Lord, I'm free.